started. So we had the definition of topological manifolds last time. They were locally Euclidean and either Hausdorff and paracompact or first countable and metric. So that was the definition. So now today I want to spend a little time using arguments where you just sort of push and pull in and out along rays. So first of all, the collar part refers to the fact that if M has a boundary, then there exists a neighborhood of the boundary homeomorphic to the boundary of M across an interval. So if you had your manifold, then and this is the boundary, then of course there's a collar around it. So this is the I factor, and etc. So you just take the definition, that's not obvious. We know that the boundary of M is what's called locally flat. Meaning that, because, well, I'll define it in a moment, but what it means here is that if you're given a point on the boundary, then because it's a manifold, and if you have a boundary, then there has to be a half open neighborhood of that point. Now, in fact, I never defined. You know, I said that for a manifold, each point has a neighborhood which is homeomorphic to Rm. Well, if it's a point on the boundary, then it has a neighborhood open. So the point here has a neighborhood, say this neighborhood U, and U is homeomorphic to Rm plus, which is equal to the set of all x1 up to xm such that xm is greater than or equal to 0. So just half space. So of course that's what you have in the boundary. So because of this fact. So let me this locally flat will come up again and I'll forget it. Let me define it for you. So an embedding, this is an aside except we'll use it later. An embedding of, let's say, MM into QQ is locally flat if for each point, say, P belonging to M, embedding is F. For each point P belonging to M, there exists a neighborhood of F of P in Q, neighborhood U, of F of P in Q, such that the pair U comma U intersect F of M is pairwise homeomorphic.
Of P.
No, M.
Oh.
Is pairwise homeomorphic to R Q comma R M. So you've got your embedding in some high dimensional, whatever the dimensions are, then there's a neighborhood like that of the point F of P, and this neighborhood is U, and that's just what it looks like. It has to look like this. It has to look like that pair. So it just means that locally it has a kind of a normal bundle. So, well, this avoids, the whole point of this is this avoids. It avoids wild embeddings. Avoids wild embeddings. So like, things like the Alexander Horn sphere or the Fox Artina arc, they're all sorts of wild things. And they all have the property that they're locally not very nice. But this prevents them. So yeah, that's what locally flat means. And in particular, the boundary of this manifold is locally flat. And here is just by definition of it being a manifold boundary. So that's kind of that's that. This is the one-dimensional case. Now, so this is a fact that this has a neighborhood homeomorphic to this. This is a theorem of Bort Brown. And it's an analyst paper, so it's the proof can't be too trivial. Though I'm going to try and make it look fairly easy. I expect it to stop when I take my finger off instead of having to tilt. It's too high. Okay. So what's the proof like? Well, so here's the boundary, here's some of the boundary, and here's the point where that's the half-open neighborhood. And then you have another one. It looks like that. Of course, actually what I'm drawing here is, this is only a one-dimensional manifold, two-dimensional manifold, the one-dimensional boundary. But what I'm saying here actually works in all dimensions. It's just, you have to think a little more. But this gives you the idea. So we have partitions of unity for these open sets. And there's a couple of ways to see this. But maybe the simplest way is just to say that inside this chart, there's a curve that looks like that. It's kind of the obvious one. It's just sort of, part way up in this half-open Euclidean space. You know, it's like the image of a parabola, upside-down parabola. That's all it is. And notice that in this chart, we can draw them straight for this one. It goes, these are just the vertical rays. It's the rays and the M coordinate. So they look like straight. Now, of course, the other one doesn't straight like that. The other ones, the rays are going to be wiggly. Well, they're certainly different. There's no reason to assume that they're going to be the same. So they look wiggly. So what is it we do to make them match up? Because of the overlap, they don't match, and that's why it's not yet a color. Well, what you do is you simply push these wiggly ones. So there's a wiggly one, for example, that comes down like this. And what do we do with it? Well, what we're going to do is just push up this far. So we're going to take it. We're going to take all of these straight rays, and just slide this up, and squeeze it. You're just squeezing it into the upper part. So you just do this every. You just push this up, and that pushes this ray, and it just wiggles a lot in here. And then the next one wiggles a lot, and so on. And they all look like this, and then they come down to where they were before. And the point now is that you have a collar which is made up of the straight ones, and then the moment when you get over to here, it's straight, and a little bit of wiggle, and less straight, and more wiggle, and less straight, and pretty soon you're over to the wiggly ones. So that's just how you match them up. Nothing more than that. But you have to take a little more care to check what's happening out here at the frontier. Make sure the partition of unity works just right. But that's the basic idea, and then it's just technique, a little bit of technique after that. Okay, so that's how that works. So now our manifolds have collars, and we can kind of forget about that issue. Now this notion of pushing things, I want to continue with that for a while. So, we'll say that a set, K and a manifold, and M manifold. Yeah, think of Euclidean space if you want. And remember, it is cellular if K is the intersection of a nested sequence of M poles, M disks. And nested means the closure of one is inside the interior of the larger one. So you see some set like that. This is K. And then there has to be a collection of balls which get down closer and closer so that the intersection of all of them is the set K itself. So this could be called B1, B1, 2, 3, 4, and the intersection has to be exactly K. Well, then there exists a arc, an isotopy, an arc of homeomorphisms from M to M. The arc runs from 0 to open 1. It's an arc of homeomorphisms such that the limit, this is HT, so the limit H1 crushes K to a point, and is a homeomorphism elsewhere. Well, imagine, just take your manifold to the arc, the reals, and here's a set K, closed. Guess I should have said closed. Closed set K. So here's your set K, and now, notice, so of course, this is the intersection of balls. There they are, they're just short intervals getting down to it. But what's the homeomorphism? Well, you take this interval and just imagine that you're squeezing it. And you squeeze it and squeeze it and squeeze it and squeeze it. And at the last moment, it becomes a point. So you've crushed it to a point. Well, how do you do it using these cells? Well, so the first time I'm going to, so these are nested and one sits inside the other. So I have a little bit of room to work. So basically, I'm going to take the outer one and the first part of this isotopy from time 0, say, to a half. From time 0 to a half, it's going to be the identity out here, and it's going to squeeze B2 to half of its size. So let's say this some detail. From during t belonging to 0 to a half, we squeeze B2 inside 1/2 B1. So if it wasn't already inside there, we squeeze it down to half the size in the coordinates of B1. Just squeeze it down. And that's certainly an isotopy. It's the identity out here, and then you're just squeezing in some. Then during T belonging to 1/2, 3/4, squeeze B3 inside See, I'm not gonna fix K here, I'm worried, no, I should have had. Yeah, it's okay. Squeeze B3 inside, one-third of B2. And you make these indices work. And then from time 3/4 to 7/8, you're gonna squeeze B4 inside something, make it smaller, and you just keep squeezing. And so the first time, over the first half hour, it's the identity out here. Over the next quarter hour, it's the identity outside B2. And then over the next whatever, it's the identity outside B3. And so you never, so a point that's not in K is only moved a finite number of times. And therefore it's, and then you stop moving. So on any point outside K, it's a nice homeomorphism and it stops after a while. And so everything is fine outside K, but it certainly is going to squeeze K to a point. So that's what a cellular map is, and this notion of squeezing is, this is sort of the simplest case of it, and I wanted to start you out with that. Now, here I'll quote a theorem, which we probably won't get to, but it's still easy to state, and I think it's kind of surprising. So this is something Larry Siemelman proved after we did our work, but it uses the torus trick and stuff like that. So what he showed was that the closure of the space of homeomorphisms of a manifold, let's make it closed, there's certainly a relative statement, but let's make it closed. So we're looking at homeomorphisms of M. And we want the closure in the space of all maps and to M, the space of all continuous maps from M to M. So that's a big space with all kinds of functions in it. They just have to be continuous. And then you have these nice homeomorphisms, which are very sparse. You'd say a sparse subset. So the closure is, I think it's interesting you can say anything at all about the closure, but it's exactly the cellular maps. And, well, I defined what a cellular set was over here. A cellular map has a property that each point inverse is cellular. Points are closed, inverse images, points are closed, and so every one of those closed sets has to be cellular. So you've seen an example of it here in the reals. I mean, we have a sequence of homeomorphisms that it converges to something which is actually still a homeomorphism. No, it's not, but it's anyway, it closes, it, that has one point inverse, which is not a point, maybe it's all of K. Well, you could have, at the same time you pinch this one, you could pinch over here, and pinch over here, and pinch over there, and pinch over there. You could, it's pretty easy to see you could pinch a countable number of intervals. It, you know, just disjoint intervals and pinch them all. Well, you can do worse things than that, but what you get are these cellular maps. So this, it's an interesting fact, I think. Okay, so I'm not going to say anything more about cellularity now, but we're going to use the same kind of ideas to get at half of the Schoenflies theorem. So remember the Schoenflies theorem? Said it said this, for giving and abetting. Say F from SN minus 1 plus minus 1, 1 into SN. Then this interval from minus 1 to 1 is to make it flat, or locally flat, to give it a collar. Then F of SN minus 1 cross 0 extends to a homeomorphism. Let's say capital F from SN to SN. So I drew a picture of this for you last time. You've got your sphere. To the inside, we have this F of SN minus 1 cross 0, and then it has a collar. That's it. So this sits in there, and we have these two closed components, A and B, and the claim is they're both, well, if A is the outside of the collar, why didn't extend A to the outside of this zero, this F and SN minus 1 cross 0. Then that region is the end ball, only work with the end ball, and the same for the other side. And then when you put those two end balls together, you end up getting this homeomorphism. So the art is to show that that each of those is the end ball. Now suppose that you could. I want to try and show that something is starting to do. Maybe the B that starts from the collar out. I want to show that that's cellular. Well, because then the argument will follow. So what we need to do is find. We need to find. Need to find an embedding of an end disk, of an end ball into SN with boundary of the end ball line and the collar. So this is what I would draw with the colors. Anyway, there should be a ball mapped in with a boundary somewhere in here. So let's imagine that the boundary looks like it's going to go along, but it's going to double back and look sort of strange, and then it's going to go around behind. So it's just a boundary mapped in there somehow. And the ball, let's say that this ball, the rest of the ball is down here. So there's a ball, it continues down this way. And you know, from here, it sort of goes, the rays sort of have to go, I don't want to clutter up the picture too much. But it's a wiggly ball, it's just some embedding of a ball in there. Now that's going to, if we could do that, then we can prove the theorem. if we can find this, then we prove the theorem by shrinking B to a point. There's the B and there's the end ball to a point. So we're going to shrink it to a point, just as we shrunk K to a point over here. we crushed it by that process. Well, we want to do the same here. Well, to do that, we want to show that B is cellular. So far, we found that B lies inside one ball, but not a nested sequence. So we want to find a nested sequence. Well, how do you get a nested sequence? Well, you just, so the collar has rays.
Spectrum.
A spectrum, yes, very good. So let's see. This is a. That's our boundary of our end ball.
On the spectrum.
And of course it goes somewhere there also. So what you do is you use the rays of the collar, I mean the rays of this product, Sn minus 1 cross the interval, you use those rays and you simply push down them. So we've got the first end ball, and there's a certain distance because it's closed. Since this red thing and the white thing are closed, there's a minimum distance between them, a compact. And so we just push the red thing down inside of itself, so it gets pushed the next one to the point. This, and then I'm going to quit because the picture will get too cluttered. So the next one's going to look like it's going to go sort of like this. And then when you get up here, it's going to have the same snaking back and forth and back. You know, something like that. So where it does this, it just gets squeezed down. And you just, that's the second one, and then do it again. The green and white are still a certain distance apart, so use these rays and squeeze the third one that's inside that, and so on and so on. So that gives you the nested sequence. And then by this, so now with the nested sequence, then you do exactly this argument. And that gives an arc, this then gives an arc of homeomorphism. Remember, it's the identity outside this. So we're going to get a homeomorphism, which is the identity out here. And it's the identity even outside the red one. And what it's going to do is squeeze B to a point.
Can I look at cellular subsets as being contractible, but in a very strong way? I mean,
contractible usually means contractible in itself.
Yeah, and are these contractible in themselves?
In themselves, not necessarily. I don't think that's necessarily true.
But they're contractible in the bigger, in
N. No, there's contractive, there's cellularity, and then there's cell-like.
Ah.
And the moment I forget. But I'm not sure. So we get an isotopy shrinking exactly B to a point at time one. That's just what was said over this board, time one. Well, what does that do? What does that do, well? So that takes the collar. We had this collar. Here's our collar. This is F of Sn minus 1 plus 0. And down here is B. And it just took all of this and shrunk it to a point. Well, what happens if you What happens if you take Sn minus 1 plus minus 1 and 1? Let's say this is a minus, let's say this is AB. This has to be the plus 1, this has to be the minus 1 out here. AB. So if you take this and you crush Sn minus 1 cross 1 to a point, then this is equal to the integral. Obviously. This is all the rays going down to the south pole, and that goes to the south pole. So that's why it's a ball. Same thing with A. So one gets a proof of the Schoenflies theorem. If you can find this ball, Bn, whose boundary is inside the collar. Well, that part of the argument is tricky. And I'll do that for you quickly next time. But it's, compared to this, I find this easy to remember. I find that argument is always hard to remember, even though it's short. So it's just tricky. You'll see what I mean, but I'll do it next time. But instead, I want to take the same ideas and take them further. So, that's the issue of tangent bundles. Did I write that? Yeah. Tangent bundles are part of the title. So we're done here with that. So now every topological manifold has a tangent bundle, a topological. Just to think for a moment what that means, normally when you have bundles, you have fibers, and over a chart, it's locally trivial, so over this little chart here, we've got a product structure, and then you go to another chart, different product, and how are the fibers sewed together? Well, the fibers are sewed together, depends. Here, you know, the most primitive case is the fibers are sewed together by a homeomorphism. There really isn't anything sort of less than that. But in the smooth case, they're sewed together by a linear map, well, usually an element of O(n). In the piecewise linear case, they're sewed together by a piecewise linear homeomorphism. You know, and all these other, if you have a Z2 bundle, they're sewed together by some element of order 2, etc. But in this case, in the general case, you do want your fibers to be the same. That's what bundle is. Well, the same, it's hard to think of anything less same than a homeomorphism. So here they have to be glued together, the fibers have to be glued together by homeomorphisms. Well, so let me mention before I forget that this is a theorem of Jim Keister about 1963, I think, an Adams paper, roughly then. He was a student of Bing about 1958 or 9, and has been at Michigan since, long retired. He's 82 now. He's my co-author for this book that I'm trying to get finished. So Jim proved this as follows. Then before that, though, I need to mention that Milner's came up with a concept of an active bundle, because there weren't any bundles at that time. So Milner did this around 1961, I think, published in Topology. And he was able to do quite a bit with these microbundles. What was a microbundle? Well, a microbundle is just a subset of n cross m. So you take n cross m. Each coordinate is m. You have a diagonal. You have a diagonal. And now you take a chart down here, copy of Rn, there's a chart. And so you have that same copy over here, and you have a little, a nice square and there. So you certainly, this is a copy of M, and if you wish, there's, you know, it's either normal or tangent. So you have this, you have these fibers to serve as fibers of a possible tangent bundle. So they're all copies of Rm, and so at each point you're assigning a copy of Rm. What are you really doing there? You've got your manifold, and at this point, it's a chart. So that's a copy of Rm, which serves as a tangent plane at that point. But then you don't know how to move it continuously in a canonical way. So you don't know how to identify it with a tangent plane nearby. That's the problem. However, you can just use that chart at that point. You could use it for all the nearby charts, which is what's happening here. We're taking this chart, and we're using that as the tangent fiber for all the nearby points. So locally, I guess that's okay. But the trouble is that when you switch to another chart, so now suppose we switch to this chart. So now that's the chart up here. And you get a box that looks like that. And there are those fibers. But on the overlap, they're not matching up by a homeomorphism. And that's the problem. That's why it's not yet a bundle. But it's a micro bundle. It had enough properties that Miller could prove some very nice theorems in this paper. But then Jim Keister, who was a fellow student of Mark Brown, doing this stuff and working on this, he knew what to do, and that's the argument he gave to turn this micro bundle into a bundle. And basically, the guts of Keister's theorem is the following. So let's see, that's like H of Rm equal to homeomorphisms of Rm with compact open topology. Maybe not everybody is familiar with a compact open topology. Should I say something?
Yes.
Probably yes, yes.
Please. Okay.
So, the easiest way to understand this is that two homeomorphisms are close if it depends on the size of the compact set. But we're going to pick a compact set in Rm, and they're close if they're close on the compact set. Now, if there's a metric around, you can just say they're within epsilon. The values, two homeomorphisms are close if on this compact set their values are within epsilon of each other. The open here, in case it's for more general cases where you don't have a metric. And then you say that the two homeomorphisms have to take the compact set into a certain open set. And that will work if there's no metric. We have a metric, so just think of this as saying that they've got to be close on a compact set. And that's the right definition. I think I mentioned this last time. If you just look at the rotations of the plane, and if you ask that, if you just said, well, homeomorphisms are close if they're within, say, some epsilon on the whole domain, in other words, all of Rm, then a rotation is not even an isotopy, because whatever your epsilon is, points far enough out are going to get moved more than epsilon. So in the non-compact case, that's the wrong definition. So here, you put in the compact set. So, you know, rotation is okay because compact sets, on the compact set, it doesn't move that much. And so then you can, so that a rotation will be an isotopy, an arc of P. So there, that's the notation, and then let's see, let's put a zero here. If they also fix the origin. And this is a deformation. These are homotopic clothing because a deformation retract from the bigger one to the smaller one. Because you can take, if any, you've got a homeomorphism. If it takes the origin out here, just translate it back. And that certainly, the deformation varies continuously with the homeomorphisms. But now what Kister did was show that,
you can raise them. Yes. You have one more pectoral.
Yeah, right. So now you also have the embeddings, x and 0, of Rn. And so this is just the embeddings. Embeddings, 0 goes to 0, of Rn into Rn. That's basis. Now notice this is sort of what you have here. You could cut down the red ones so that the red fibers, if you just shrunk it on this overlap here, if you just shrunk it, then the red ones would be embedded in the white ones, but they wouldn't be onto. So what we do here is this deformation retracts to H0 to homeomorphism. If you have embeddings that fix 0, you can retract that space to, it's a deformation retract. It fixes itself, fixes the embeddings, and brings everything else to homeomorphisms. Okay, so I'm going to do this with a picture. No surprise. So here's Rn. And the origin, and now we have an embedding. So it looks sort of like this. Should be in red. There it is. This is some H of Rn. It's an embedding. Now, what if I want to expand that out? I want to push it out. So, in some sense, it's like taking the complement. You can imagine this Rn as Sn. There's a point of infinity, if you like. And you can imagine taking this complement and shrinking it to a point. And then that would drag the homeomorphism onto. So if you think of the point at infinity out there, and then you just want to drag this out there in order to make it onto. And we got to do this canonically. In other words, the whatever construction I make here has to vary continuously as little h varies throughout the embeddings. So it should be done canonically. Well, it's not so hard. Let's see. So what you do is, well, if you think of, we've got to get something to sort of push out with. So there's a maximum round ball that fits inside, whose interior is inside H of Rn. So there exists a largest, so we'll call it R naught times Vm. That's the ball of radius little r naught. There's just the largest one inside H of Rn. So H belongs to this embedding. What is our embedding? I hope this is visible. Okay, so then the largest R naught, and so now we'll take half that, and we're going to call that something. This will be naught. So here it is. It's like this, because that's about halfway between, not quite my picture, but it's supposed to be. So this is B naught. Then inside that, there's a maximal red ball which fits inside there, and then we take half of that in the red coordinates. So now we've got something that looks like this, where it's sort of halfway in or something. So this is going to be, I guess, we'll call it B1. So choose a ball half the radius. Maximal H of RBN inside, well, it fits inside B naught. Do you think this red is going to show up well enough in the camera?
Yeah. Right.
Right over the. Okay, so then you've got that. And now, if you wish, if one wishes, we can get another one inside that by the same argument, another round one that's sort of half the size. And we can keep on doing this as long as we want it, but this is enough. Now, notice these choices are canonical because of this thing about the largest ball that varies continuously as this H varies. And so this is the only choice I'm really going to make. Now, having picked these, we now just sort of start pushing out. So how do you push out? Well, it's sort of the cellularity argument only going out. And so we want to push the yellow one out close to this dotted rib. So the complement of the yellow is like the first of that nested sequence. I mean, if you like, you can have the point at infinity and then it really is a ball. But that doesn't make it doesn't really crucial that you do that. So you push the yellow using the red coordinates, the wiggly red coordinates, you push the yellow out a ways, and that gives you the next yellow one. And then you push it out further, and that gives you the next one. Then you push it out further, and that gives you the next one. So you get a whole nested sequence. When you're doing this, so the next one, so using the red coordinates, construct a nested sequence. I'll call them outer, because it's going out. This is the outer end balls. The end ball's got the point of infinity in them. So now you have that, and then you just go through the same argument as up there, and that argument drags this complement, k. So k is going to go way off to the point at infinity. Just push it all out. And that's a process then to take all embeddings and push them all out to the to be onto. And notice that if it was already onto, then the largest ball that you can put in here is already everything. It's already everything. So you don't have to do anything with the ones which are already homeomorphisms. But if you think about it, that's continuous, because if your red one was onto except a little bit out here, well, then your yellow thing would be very big to start with, and you just move a little bit, and so on. So anyway, this proves this fact. So this is Keister's key idea, and it's a version of Mort Brown's cellularity, only it's done carefully with this canonical. You have to make it very continuously. Okay, now then with that. With that, we get bundles.
If yes. You press the number 3, then that probably does what you want.
The number 3?
On that keyboard, there should be a 3.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, unfortunately, they weren't using the right order. Okay, sorry, that didn't work.
Oh, so maybe I wanted...
Well, there's 3 preset configurations, but obviously that didn't work out.
So
sorry.
Right, I see what you mean, though. This one up. Now, using that theorem about homeomorphisms, it's kind of a slightly technical, in the same way that the coloring could be technical. So, what is it you do? Well, actually, did I want this down? As I said before, you just take a piece of this red. I mean, you just sort of cut this off. You look at a small over. You look at a little bit. Let me blow it up so you can see it. So, what we have is that open chart, that chart, and this chart. And then in the diagonal here, you see a great big box. And another big box. Too low. So this is the overlap box. Well then, how do you make a bundle out of this? Well, you want to make this red bundle sort of come down like this. Let's see, sort of have it come down like that. And pull the red, shrink. See, here you have these fibers. Well, just shrink and saw. So the fibers get shorter and shorter, and now you have fibers from here on. You have fibers which are embeddings. The red is inside the white. Well, then just use that to blow it up to make it onto. So that will make it onto the white. So now using Keister, sort of in this smaller part, you expand the red all the way. You just take these and expand them. Over here. And now the white fibers are here. And and they just merge into the red ones, and then the red ones, and then you cut this off like that, and so they just sort of merge up and like that. And that's basically the argument. You have to fuss a little, make sure, you know. You have to fuss with open coverings and the way that things overlap, and just make sure it works. But there's not, it doesn't. You could all sit down and figure it out. It's like a homework exercise in point set topology. Don't think it requires anything. It's a nuisance to write down. But okay, so that gives us topological bundles. It's time's up.
Almost. I have a question. Yes. Going back to the Siebelmann theorem. So my understanding, if you're wrong, is that if you have a cellular map, then it's easy to show that it's the closure of the homomorphisms. Is that the easy part? The difficult part and the easy part. The easy, constructive part is if you start with a cellular map, that it's close to homomorphism.
Yeah, I think I don't think that's so easy. I think it follows from the Bing shrinking.
Okay, but it's a geometric construction.
It's geometric construction.
Right, and then it's what I would call more or less an algebraic. Well, algebraic is the wrong word. But you need the kind of high-dimensional stuff more in going back.
You need the torus trick.
Do you need the torus trick both ways or just one way?
I think just the one way.
The which way?
One is Bing shrinking and the other one is a torus trick.
Exactly. So
that's what I think.
So, you need...
I looked at this and 30 years or something.
That's okay. The idea is that you have this geometric condition of cellular maps, which gives you homomorphisms.
Yeah.
And then you need some kind of torus trick to take an arbitrary homomorphism and approximate it by cellular maps.
Right.
And is... Okay, that's what I wanted to say. I wanted to check that, to say.
Okay. I think that's right.
Thank you.
And, any other questions? So, yes. Thank you.
Thank you very much.